Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back to the Islam and Life's third segment. As you all know, today we are discussing about one of the major sins, missing zakat. We learned lots of things from our Shaykh and we heard lots of things about zakat and why zakat is important and why you should not miss the zakat. But this segment we'll try to answer the questions we received and we also take your calls. You can call us on the given number at the screen. It's 02-7096-0405. Without further delay, let's welcome our Shaykh once again. Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
So if you allow us, I can read the questions and so we can answer.
Inshallah.
Yes, that we have a question from one of the viewers. That what is the best, it's not related, but it's very important. What is the best solution to minimize dispute in marriages?
MashaAllah, very nice question somebody has asked. What is the best way of minimize dispute in the marriage life? MashaAllah, very nice question. And it's one, you know, the relevant question somebody has asked, MashaAllah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them the great rewards for that. But brothers and my sisters, as far as marriage life is concerned, is two individuals get together in the marriage life and with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In order to maintain that marriage life, the best thing which be supportive for us to maintain that marriage life in the best conduct and the best way is to have the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have to have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if a person has the piety, if a person has the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he or she, they will be mindful, they will be able to fulfill the right of the other people. So spouses together, the husband and wife together, if they have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will be able to fulfill the rights of one another. If there is no fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then at that time somebody might be selfish, somebody might be deceiving, and they will not be fulfilling the rights of each other. Therefore, the first and the foremost duty we should have in the marriage life is the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the first verse of Surah An-Nisa, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the first man and the first woman, Adam and Eve, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, Ya ayyuhan nas, inna khalaqnakum min zakarin wa untha. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ الله سبحانه وتعالى يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها. That all people, we have created you from one man and one woman. Okay. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. In this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the command of the taqwa more than one times. That fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام. And fear Allah, that with the name of Allah, you ask one another for your rights. And with the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can maintain the kinship with your relatives. So as far as the taqwa, as the piety is concerned, the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is concerned, that's the only thing which can enable a person to fulfill the rights of their partners and their spouses. Second thing, my brothers and my sisters, as far as the marriage life is concerned, it's not like for one day or two day or a week or a month or a year, it's for until the death of a person, for the couples. The second thing we should have is the understanding, is the mutual trust with one another, that she is my wife and I am her husband. Okay, and she thinks he is my husband and I am his wife. Okay, once the mutual understanding will be there, the given and giving and taking attitude will be there, then at that time many of the disputes will be dissolved and will come to an end. The third thing we should have in the marriage life is the trust. The wife trust the husband and the husband trust the wife. Because as far as husband and wife is concerned, the best way it could be explained, the relation, is in the Quran. Allah has said, Hunna libasul lakum wa antum libasul lahun. They are your clothing and you are their clothing. So when he puts the garments and the clothing on, what does he want? What does he want? That he looks nice and beautiful. Yeah. So a person has a wife and a wife has a husband. Okay, they are living in a life that one of them is considered the clothing for the other one. When they are considered as clothing for the one another, when a person puts the clothes on, he likes to be neat and clean and smart and comfortable. So in the married life as well, when a person has a spouse and they're married to each other, then they like to be comfortable, neat and tidy, and be trustworthy to each other and respected by one another. Therefore, in the married life, the fourth thing we should have is the mutual respect. A respect of one another. Fifth one, if there is any kind of thing happens in the married life, that any kind of dispute, first of all, husband and wife, because they are the married couple, they are the mature people, they both should sit down and try to resolve the issue by discussing amongst themselves without interference of any other people from outside of the family. If they can sit down and negotiate and talk to themselves and resolve the issue, that's alhamdulillah, that's very good. And this is how it should be. However, if the thing has gone beyond, sometimes over the limit a bit, and by discussing of the both parties, both of the couple, the husband and the wife, it seems like it may not come to the solution. Therefore, the guardians from the both parties should can be involved, and the guardians from the both parties can sit down and negotiate and try to solve the issue. My brothers and my sisters, with regards to the marriage, never come to a conclusion, never haste to a decision without taking all these cautions, because it's not a joke that you just quickly break up the marriage. In fact, you take caution and you always take with the talent and with wisdom, and you always be wise in order to make any decisions with regards to marriage disputes. Jazakumullah khair.
Jazakallah Shaykh. Let's go to our next question. It is, what is the best time to give zakat?
MashaAllah, barakallah. It's related to our topic as well, that what is the best time to give zakat, somebody has asked. My brothers and my sisters, as far as giving zakat is concerned, you can give it any time of the year. But one thing you have to remember, that you have to remember your zakat year. For example, in England, the tax year is 5th of April. So every year, when the 5th of April comes, the new zakat, new tax year starts. Okay? So you have to give the account of the previous. So this year, 2017, 5th of April came. Now 2016, you have to give the accounts. Okay? And then when next year, 2018, the 5th of April will come, you have to give the accounts for the 2017. Okay? So similarly, you have to remember your zakat year. For example, if you are giving zakat according to Islamic year, for example, Muharram to Muharram, the next Muharram you have to be ready for the zakat of the whole of the Islamic year. If you are giving January to January, then January 2018, from January 2017 to January 2018, you can calculate your zakat. However, it's preferable to give in the month of Ramadan. And the reason is, in the month of Ramadan, the acts, the rewards of the actions are multiplied by many, many, many times. Therefore, by giving zakat in the month of Ramadan, you are getting the reward of the zakat, plus it's getting multiplied because of the holy month of Ramadan. Similarly, by giving it in the month of Ramadan, you are supporting the needy in the holy month of Ramadan. And supporting the needy in the holy month of Ramadan, it is superior to supporting the needy other than the month of Ramadan. It doesn't mean out of the month of Ramadan we don't support them. It's nothing like that. We do support them. But when we support somebody in the holy month of Ramadan, it has more of the rewards. Like in the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that if a person provides the iftar meal to a person who is fasting, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give the same amount of reward to the person who provided the iftar to the fasting person. The reward the fasting person will have, Allah will provide the same reward to the person who has provided the iftar gift. Okay? Without decreasing any rewards for the person who was fasting. Allahu. So what does it indicate? That you are just supporting him and he is fasting. Okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you rewards as well for providing iftar to him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give the person rewards as well for fasting in the holy month of Ramadan. So therefore, ulama say it's recommended in the holy month of Ramadan that we give our zakat out in the holy month of Ramadan. When in the month of Ramadan, we have the chance to support the many other people. And when in the month of Ramadan, we have the chance of the rewards getting multiplied by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Barakallah.
Jazakallah, Shaykh. Thank you very much. I think you elaborated the answer very... very well, and let's move on to our next questions. It's also related to zakat, and okay. How can a person give the zakat of the year he or she missed?
Okay, mashallah, very nice, very nice question, barakallah. It's like many people ask the question that what is the procedure of making the missed salah. Okay. Like the way we have to make the missed salah, same way, my brothers and my sisters, we have to make the missed year's zakat as well. And the reason behind that is the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are not allowed to neglect and abuse the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If somebody has borrowed money from somebody and he could not pay it in the 1 year, second year, third year, it doesn't mean that after these years the money is automatically deleted or is forgiven by the person who has lent the money. No, even eventually we have to give the zakat, we have to give the money back to the person. Same way, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the wealth, we have to pay zakat, we have to take zakat out every year, which is the 2.5%. If for any reason, any negligence, if a person never knew or he was not aware, or for any reason, if a person has missed the zakat of the previous years, then what is the procedure for taking the zakat out? For example, we are now in the Ramadan, nearly coming to the Ramadan 2017. So just say, for example, somebody missed the zakat from Ramadan 2015, 2016, 2017. Okay, last past 3 years. Okay, now what is the procedure for calculating the zakat of that person? Okay. Now, as all of us in England, we can verify how much of the earning we have every year. So that person, he can verify from Ramadan 2014 to Ramadan 2015, this was his earning. After all his necessities taken out, this much money he had left. He has on his saving. Same for the 2015 to 2016, and same for the 2016 to 2017, which is the current year. For example, past 3 years, every year, after all the necessities, he had the saving of £5,000 each year. And he has missed 3 years zakat. Now, this 3, 5 times by 3, 15,000. Okay? £15,000, from there, you only take 2.5% out for the last 3 years, and that will be given to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Okay, I think we have a caller on the line. Let's take the call. Assalamu alaikum, caller. Hello? Assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum assalam.
Yeah, I have a question about Umrah.
Yes.
Yeah, what I want to know is we are going to Umrah tomorrow, inshallah.
Inshallah.
Yeah, so we are leaving house in the morning at 6 o'clock. So my wife wants to make intention and get ready for Umrah before she leaves house. But the fajr starts at 5 o'clock in the morning. So how would she make intention and when would she read her nafal namaz and get ready to go to Umrah? Can you please answer this question?
Okay, thank you, brother. Do you have any other question?
Yeah, one more question is, once we get to Mokka, can we change Umrah cloth, have a shower and put another different Umrah cloth again? And can a woman do the same?
Okay, Jazakallah, brother. Thank you very much for your questions. Our Shaykh will answer that. Thank you. Yeah, let's take another call, please.
Okay.
Yes. Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum assalam.
Yes, caller.
I'm the one speaking from France.
Mashallah. Okay, mashallah, brother. Thank you for your call.
Okay, so I want to know in Salat, the first rakat and second rakat after Alhamdulillah, we have to read another surah, okay?
Yeah.
So normally we heard before, normally we need to read minimum 3 ayat, d'accord?
Yes.
So if I read Qulillahumma malikal mulki tu'til mulka man tasha, this is the 2 ayat, okay? And laqad ja'akum rasulun min anfusikum azizun alayhi ma anittum harif. This is also the 2 ayat, okay? The end. So if I read the Qulillahumma and Laqad Ja'akum, so my salat will be okay?
Okay, Jazakallah, brother. Thank you very much for your questions. Do you have any other questions? We'll try to answer that.
You understand what I...
Yes,
what
I did. I think we did understand.
Okay, thank you very much.
Any other questions?
No.
Okay, Jazakallah, brother. Thank you very much for your call from France. Okay, so we received the first questions about the Umrah.
Mm-hmm.
One of the brother and his wife is planning to go Umrah by tomorrow, and how the niyyah procedure or how they do the intention.
Barakallah, jazakumullah. MashaAllah, jazakallah, brother, who is going for Umrah with the family, mashaAllah. First of all, our request is please remember us in your du'as, inshaAllah, in the spiritual journey of the Umrah, inshaAllah. As far as putting the ihram on is concerned, as you have said, your wife wants to do it around 6 o'clock and Fajr starts around 5 o'clock. MashaAllah, as far as putting the ihram on is concerned, the procedure is that you pray 2 rakat of nafal salah, and preferably before that you take a shower and then take the recite the 2 rakat of nafal salah, and then the ihram you have, you put it on, and then you make the niyyah by saying labbaik allahumma labbaik, labbaik la sharika laka labbaik, innal hamda wan ni'mata laka wal mulk la sharika lak. Now 6 o'clock, I don't know where the brother has called from, because 6 o'clock in London, in Birmingham, is still just before sunrise. Okay, So I think what she can do is that before the Fajr Salah, she prays her two rakat of Nafal Salah for Ihram, and then prays her Fajr Salah, and then she puts the, she says the Labbaik, because the ladies don't have the special garments. It's the clean garments which they normally wear. That's the clothes they wear as well. And then she makes the intention by saying Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik Labbaik Allah Sharika Laka Labbaik. However, if somebody, if the brother is calling from somewhere where the sunrise will be at that time, from 6 o'clock, then advisable will be wait for the sun to rise, and after the sunrise, read the two rakat, and then she can make the intention for ihram by saying Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik Labbaik Allah Sharika Laka Labbaik. So you have to bear in mind that where you calling for, my brother, if it's the time of sunrise, then wait for the sunrise and then put the ihram on. And if it is not the sunrise time, then at that time what do you do is that pray your Fajr Salah, pray your ihram first, ihram Salah first, and then pray your Fajr Salah, and then put the ihram on, because after once you prayed your Fajr, you are not allowed to read any nafal until the sunrise. Second one, you said once you go to the Umrah, are you allowed to take your ihram clothes off and put the new clothes on? Yes, you are allowed. You're allowed to take the shower and you can change your ihram clothes and put the new one on. No problem. Same with sisters as well. They can change their normal clothes, take a shower, change their normal clothes and put a new pair of clothes on, and they can go and proceed and perform their Umrah. Inshallah, that will be allowed as well. Barakallah.
Jazakallah, Shaykh. Let's go back to our second caller. He asks the questions about the first and two rakat.
MashaAllah. Very nice question. Jazakallah, brother, for calling from France. Please make us make dua for us, inshallah, and view our program, inshallah, watch our program. Jazakallah. Very nice question. That in the books it says that a person, when he recites Surah Fatiha, then joins a surah or minimum three ayah. Okay. Now his question was, as far as I understood, that if he recites a long ayah and that's one ayat, is that enough or not? Okay. So if the surah is joined to Surah Fatiha, that's fine, totally no problem. Any surah could be like shortest one, like Surah Al-Kawthar or Surah Al-Asr. Okay, and your name is Al-Kawthar as well, mashallah. Okay, so any surah which is short, that will be enough, that will be sufficient. If it is not a surah, then if it is small ayah, small verses, then three minimum verses. Because if you just recite one small verse, then it may have the link with the previous verse, or it may have link with the next verse. Therefore, whatever you have recited, it may not give the full meaning of it. Okay, it may have an incomplete meaning remaining. Sometimes it has the link with the previous verse and it has the link with the next verse. Therefore, jurists, they have said, if it is short verses, then three verses. However, if it is a long verse, then one verse will be sufficient. Okay, like Qulillahumma Malik al-Mulk. It's a long verse and the whole verse explains what Allah Ta'ala is trying to say, that the sovereignty and the kingdom belongs to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Therefore, one long verse is enough. Similarly, Laqad ja'akum rasulun min anfusikum, that verse as well, one ayat, okay, until the end of Surah Tawbah. Okay, so one verse, okay, so if it's one verse, long verse, it gives the full meaning, then it is enough. So therefore, Laqad ja'akum rasulun min anfusikum, azizun alayhi ma anittum, harisun alaykum bil mu'minina, raufur rahim. فَقُلْ حَسْبِيَ اللَّهِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ عَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْتُ وَهُوَ رَبُّ الْعَرْشِ الْعَظِيمِ. Two verses, okay? But one of them is sufficient because it gives the complete meaning. However, if you finish the both together, that will also be better, okay? And perfect, inshallah. So if it's short ayat, three ayat, and if it is long ayat, one ayat should be sufficient. However, if you want to make the long ayat more than one, and if they have connection, then it's better to recite more than one as well. But as far as the validity of salah is concerned, one ayat will be sufficient. Barakallah.
Jazakallah, Shaykh. I think our brother has got his answer.
Inshallah.
Let's move on to our next questions, as we do not have enough time. What is the nisab of the zakat?
MashaAllah, barakallah. Very nice question. That what is the nisab of zakat? From gold, the nisab is 20 dinar, which is equivalent nowadays in the grams of gold is 87.48 grams, or is equal in money form. And if it is silver, then 200 dirham, nowadays is equivalent in the grams, 612 point something. I forgot the point. Okay, it's just over 612 point something grams.
Okay,
it's over 612 grams. Over 612 grams. If a person has, normally nowadays people have gold, very rare people have silver. So take the gold, so 87.48 grams of gold, or it's equivalent in money, and that person has that money for one complete year. After taking the necessities from there, he has to, or she has to, pay zakat, which is 2.5% only. Barakallah.
Jazakallah, Shaykh. Thank you very much. This question is,
or in another way, in 100, 2.50p.
Yes.
In 1,000, 25 pounds.
Yes.
So just easily remember it like that. In every 1,000, 25 pounds.
25 pounds.
Okay. So if somebody has 10,000, then 10 25s, which is 250 pounds. So 250 pound given to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, 9,750 remains to the owner. Barakallah.
Jazakallah, Shaykh. Thank you very much. We have another question about what is the purpose and procedure of istikhara salah?
MashaAllah, Barakallah. Very nice question. What is the purpose and the procedure of istikhara salah? Istikhara literally means to seek good from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When somebody is thinking regarding something legal in the Sharia to do, at that time he cannot make the decision. Then he or she pray 2 rak'at of salah, and end of the salah they pray a long dua, or if they cannot do it in Arabic, after praying these 2 rak'ah, they make a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in their own language, that, "Wa Allah, this is something which I intend to do." But does it actually have good in it or bad in it? I don't know. But you know. So, "Wa Allah, I am seeking good about it. Please, Wa Allah, guide me about it." Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will support that person regarding that issue, and that is known as istikhara. Sayyiduna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to highly recommend the sahaba doing istikhara. He used to teach them the salatul istikhara, the seeking khair, seeking good from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, this is the procedure of istikhara salah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide the person. However, this is to be made when the person has not made the decision yet. Once you have made the decision of doing so and then making the istikhara, it's like you are not asking Allah Ta'ala for the consultation. You have made the decision, then you are asking Allah Ta'ala to put the barakah in it. Okay, therefore ulama, they have said, it's highly recommended that when you are not sure about it, then making the istikhara and asking Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala for the good, that is the valid way of doing it. Barakallah.
Jazakallah, Shaykh. Thank you very much. And we have the next questions about that. What is the ruling regarding those people who say, "We only believe in Quran"? It's a very different type of questions. But
I understand. My brothers and my sisters, as far as Al-Quran is concerned, it's the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the explanation of the Quran is the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith, he has stated that "Utiitu al-Quran wa mithlahu ma'ahu," that I have given by Allah azza wa jalla the holy book Quran and the similar amount of explanation of the holy Quran. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent every time a book with a prophet. Because a book without the explanation of the prophet is not sufficient. Similarly, a prophet without the book of guidance is not sufficient. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put the system in place as Kitabullah and Rijalullah. The men of Allah and the book of Allah. Men of Allah, prophets and the messengers alayhi salatu wasalam, books of Allah, all the books Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent. Therefore, each book has a prophet, and prophet explains that book. Our Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the last messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was given the book of Allah, and Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given the explanation of the Holy Quran. Therefore, we have to take the Quran and Sunnah both into consideration, because they are cooperative to one another. You cannot imagine Sunnah without Quran, nor you cannot explain Quran without the Sunnah. They are supportive to one another. Therefore, to say only Quran is sufficient for me, I don't believe in anything else, this is misguidance, this is totally wrong, it is not allowed. Therefore, we have to take Quran and we have to take the Sunnah as well, because of the Quranic verse Allah Azza wa Jalla has said, "وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ." Whatever Rasul gives you as the explanation as well, take that. And whatever he prevents, and you have to refrain from it. That وَأَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولُ. Obey the commands of Allah and obey the command of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Therefore, somebody saying, "I only believe in Quran, nothing else," is totally wrong. It is not from the Islamic ethos. It is not from the Islamic motive. Barakallahu khair.
Jazakallah, Shaykh. With this answer, okay, we are at the very end of our today's show.
Allahu
so
Akbar.
We will not be able to answer any more questions.
Allahu Akbar.
I would like to thank on behalf of all of the audience to you that thank you very much, and Jazakallah khairan for being here with once again.
Barakallah.
And thank you for your valuable time.
Jazakallah.
We hope to have you on next week, inshallah.
Inshallah.
So allow us to leave now.
Inshallah.
Dear viewers, the time has gone and we are at the very end of our today's show. Please forgive us if we do any mistakes, and please bear with us for the next week at the same time. We'll come back with a new topic and very relevant topic at the Islam and Life. Thank you very much once again. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.